There are not too many places in Oklahoma City where you can escape from traffic signs, road barriers, and warning lights. These traffic control devices are designed to help ensure the safety of motorists and pedestrians. Only in many cases, the city-owned property ends up in someone's home or, more often, dormitory rooms. The city says removing traffic control devices for souvenirs is not only dangerous, but expensive to replace. So today, the city council voted to raise fines to $300 and/or 90 days in jail for those found guilty of taking city property. Stolen traffic signs also cause other problems for city officials.
One of the things that prompted the action, Ed, was a recent claim that the city paid where a street barricade had been removed and there was damage to an automobile. Of course, city council has recognized for quite a while that removing a stop sign, one was removed up on Memorial Road and a life was lost. So we've recognized for quite some time that we were somewhat lax in that area, and as a result, we've increased the fine.
City officials are counting on the public's help by reporting anyone seen tampering with a traffic sign or barrier. In cases where juveniles are found guilty of sign stealing, the maximum fine is $100 and no jail sentence. The council warns the penalty could get tougher if that's what it takes to keep the signs where they belong. Ed Stewart, Action 4.
The local postman has been recognized as a traditional part of American life since the days of Norman Rockwell. Their courage and gallantry has been carried by memories of friendly chats and letters delivered no matter what the weather. Well, that image has now gone one step further. To help her, starting today, our local postman can now serve as a watchdog on us. The program's called Carrier Alert and enables the mailman to contact emergency agencies if something seems wrong.
Actually read about it.
Guidelines for the service were announced today at a press conference. Carrier Alert is available to those that live alone, especially the elderly and handicapped. Its co-sponsor, the Red Cross, asks only that the applicant have an external mailbox. Other than that, there's no charge.
But with this system, a person who knows that they may have potential danger in their home of falling, or who has a medical problem that knows that they could have an attack, such as a stroke, in their home and be left unable to get help themselves, can register in advance. And the first notice of any buildup of mail, the carrier will attempt to notify us and we'll get involved in the system to try to find out about their well-being.
If you'd like to register for Carrier Alert or just find out more about the service, call the Red Cross at 232-7121. Sherry Sellers, Action 4.
Independent drivers nationwide park their rigs to protest federal highway taxes. But Oklahoma independents are also worried about state fees. Four Oklahoma truckers wheeled into Governor Nye's office today to find out how the chief executive feels about their problems.
His overall position, for as far as trucking is concerned, is he's in support of our trucking, and we in Oklahoma don't have a problem with the new state tax fees that they're trying to get onto us. Oklahoma will not have any raises in their license plates for next year, and basically he told us that he's in support of what we're doing.
The truckers' next stop will be Washington. The independents plan to visit the Oklahoma congressional delegation within the next few weeks. They want to see what can be done on the federal level to help hold down the high cost of truck transportation. The truckers seem satisfied with today's meeting here at the state capitol. It remains to be seen whether they'll be this happy after they've made the rounds in Washington, D.C. Scott Wallace, Action 4 at the state capitol.
Fluoride is combined with organic materials, it produces something called trihalomethane. Oklahoma City does have a higher level of trihalomethane in its drinking water than the government allows, and at least one water company is using that fact as a scare tactic. Many Oklahoma City residents are receiving phone calls and visits from people claiming to be with the city. And they're telling residents they need to buy water softeners and purification products in order to get rid of trihalomethane. But the city says the representatives are imposters, and there is no danger in drinking city water.
Well, they're telling them to look at the back of their water bill, and that's proof that their water isn't safe. There's a little box on the back of the water bill that shows that city water doesn't meet one standard. It doesn't mean the water isn't safe to drink. It's a standard imposed by the Environmental Protection Agency, but unless you're drinking 100 gallons of water a day, you're in no danger. But they're using that to frighten people because it's technical and ominous sounding.
City officials say their employees have proper identification, and if someone claims to be with the city, make that person prove it. The city also encourages residents to get names or phone numbers from people using the trihalomethane scare tactic. The information will be used to trace companies the city wants to put out of business. Ed Stewart, Action 4.
The arrests in Midwest City this weekend are the result of an investigation that began last October. Investigators have aimed at the source of drugs going to Midwest City juveniles in schools and youth hangouts. Already, the probe has netted 21 arrests in December and 51 warrants for 31 suspects this weekend. Some of those suspects are already in custody on other charges. The Midwest City Police Chief says the probe is continuing, and under an accepted standard for measurement, it's a success.
As late as yesterday, we determined with the price that was being asked of us at that time that the amount that the same quantity of narcotic would cost you at this time in Oklahoma City would cost you about twice as much out here. So the people, because of the fact that we are arresting people rather routinely now, drives the price of the product up.
The undercover work was done by officers who looked young enough to pass as high school students. Cox says for these and other investigations to work, enforcement must be meaningful, swift, and certain. Midwest City Police say they believe that's the message these arrests will send out. Charles Schnitzer, Action 4, in Midwest City.
Bryant County has just completed construction on a brand new $1.2 million jail. And the sheriff, Gene Hampton, is glad to finally be in compliance with state jail standards. Sheriff Hampton doesn't get out in the field much anymore. He has been served with 7 different lawsuits, all stemming from the dilapidated state of the old jail. The sheriff doesn't hassle with jail inspectors anymore either. He operates the most modern county lockup in the state. Everything here is mechanized, right down to the electric doorknobs. Even the toilets in the jail can be flushed from one master switch. But Bryan County Sheriff Gene Hampton does have one problem. He's had to fire 1/3 of his deputies to make payments on the jail. Today, only 2 deputies patrol the 1,200 square miles of Bryan County.
Those legislators, they don't care whether I like it or not. You know, I either do it or else. And like then they make all the rules and regulations to run a jail. The only problem is we don't get any money to run them, you know, to run the jail on. I mean, it has to come from the people of Bryan County, and in my opinion, that's not right. If they set the rules and regulations for this jail, then they should come up with some of the money.
Here, prisoners have all the luxuries of home. Special visiting quarters, their own private rooms with adjoining recreational areas, and central heating and air conditioning. And although the Bryan County Jail does meet state standards, the sheriff now fears that the department's main function of protecting the county will be neglected. Another problem that county sheriffs face is the constantly changing jail standards. When this facility was first built, this enclosed courtyard was mandatory. If this jail were to be built today, the county would not have had to go on to the added expense. County sheriffs are at the mercy of the county excise board. And the excise board in this community says they can't afford this facility. In Durant, Kurt Autry, Action 4.
Building a county
The Tax Equity and Fiscal Responsibility Act of 1982, passed by Congress this past summer, will go into effect on July 1st. What the legislation means is that banks, credit unions, money market, and other mutual fund corporations will be forced to withhold 10% on all of the interest that you earn. Every interest-yielding account at your local bank will be affected, except the individual retirement account. According to one local bank executive, details of the tax plan are still sketchy, but she knows that each one of her customers will be affected.
The banks will have to set up some or devise some type of bookkeeping system to charge the customer as to the amount of interest we're paying them. And we'll have to set that in some type of an account. And I don't know whether they're going to charge us on a quarterly basis or an annual basis, how we're going to submit it at this time. We haven't been told.
Thousands of cards and letters protesting the scheduled tax have been pouring into the offices of Oklahoma's congressional delegation. Mickey Edwards' office confirms they've received more than 10,000 letters calling for the repeal of that bill. At least 28 bills are pending that would repeal the act, and many local bank customers and lending institutions are hoping they'll succeed. Kurt Autry, Action 4.
Help for these families has come in the form of a meeting, a gathering just for the loved ones of county commissioners. Only they can understand what each wife, child, and relative has been going through, the loneliness, the embarrassment, and the anger. This is a special kind of new support group called Okies for Oklahoma. Help is the key word here, and it's offered by everyone.
So when you get anger going inside of you, find someone that will listen to you. Find someone that's safe. Take it out. Take a pillow, if nothing else, and punch your pillow.
I don't express my anger like a lot of people do. It's all inside, you know. It's the, like the psychologist is talking about. It's sleepless nights and things like that. It's not something that I can express openly.
The anger is a true problem for the families, but the hardest part, the most painful problem, is the loneliness.
My husband had a heart attack just as he went in the gate. He was in the prison hospital for 10 days. He is still an ill man. And you have to think about that all night. Besides, the paper publishes your name. Then any con man or rapist or thief can very easily find out where you live and that you are alone. And there are an awful lot of us in that position.
Each of these families is having to learn to live all over again. Perhaps with the support of Okies for Oklahoma, they'll find the way a little easier and a lot less painful. Sherry Sellers, Action 4 in El Reno.
We have a buku of volunteers from the railroad club that came out and gave us time. And so it's a big, solid team effort. And it was really nice to work with them. It was a lot of work. And I'm glad it came this far.
Paul Henry Carr grew up in Chakota, Oklahoma. He helped his parents grow cotton and corn on the family farm when he wasn't playing football or teasing his eight sisters. Being the only boy in the family, Paul did not have to answer the call to service in World War II, but Paul wanted to fight for his country. He was a gunner's mate on the destroyer escort Samuel B. Roberts on October 25, 1944, during the battle for the Philippine Islands. Paul Carr became a hero that day, fiercely fighting the Japanese even after he was fatally wounded. 38 years after his death, the Navy decided to honor young Carr by naming a new guided missile frigate after him. The hero's eight sisters and his widow will travel to Seattle this weekend for the launching of the USS Carr. The ceremony brings back bittersweet memories.
That it's been emotional for us and brought back a lot of good memories. And, of course, the day we received the telegram, the bad memory of it, too.
Tressie, what are some of the thoughts which will be going through your mind this weekend when you attend the launching ceremony?
It's just an inspirational thing for me, really. I just feel like we're all getting together and meeting his shipmates, you know. None of us have ever seen them. And we'll get to talk to them, people that were right there with him on that ship then. And we'll make lots of good new friends. And it's just like a bond now with us, with his buddies.
After 39 years, Paul Henry Carr will return to the Navy's active duty list this weekend when the traditional champagne bottle breaks across the bow of the USS Carr. And once again, Paul Henry and his eight sisters will be reunited. Scott Wallace, Action 4 in Muskogee.
It'll probably further cut the number of rigs are operating because it's less feasible to drill for $27 oil than it was for $35 or $40 oil. Taking the same risks and your returns are going to be fewer.
It's my pleasure to present to you on behalf of the Oklahoma Bankers Association and Northwest Bank $500 cash reward for your part in solving the robbery.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Don, same to you. I appreciate
it very much.
Thank you.
All I want Senator Bellmon to do is to realize that the legislature exists, that it is over here, and it is going to have some say-so about this matter and others like it. I'm not calling for Senator Bellmon's resignation. I'm asking Senator Bellmon to be a little bit more candid and a little bit more open and a little bit more forthright with the legislature and what his plans are for the very things that that this legislature has a great deal of responsibility for.
Told me that he was very desperate and that to listen to exactly what he was going to say. And he told me that to go to the bank at 9 o'clock and get $20,000 in old bills.
Right.
And then at 10 o'clock to go to the first bridge south on Highway 99 and drop the money off by the river. And he said then go back to your office because the phones at the house don't work and wait for a call. He said if he has any inclination that we've contacted the police or he sees any police, that we'll never see this child alive again.
So we was coming down Apache and then a truck pulled in front of us and a bus driver tried to quit from hitting the bus and other trucks was coming from us this way and we just swung and hit that pole over there and hit the curb and turned over.
What was it like in the bus during the time of the accident?
Slow. We was going. It felt like we was going slow because it was a whole lot of people on top of me.
Children's Hospital in Oklahoma City is just one of the hospitals in the state running out of room to take care of sick newborn infants. Last year, 36 babies ended up in cities like Dallas, Fort Worth, and Wichita, Kansas, because there were not enough beds. When the Department of Human Services enacted its furlough policy, the problem was compounded. There won't be enough nurses to take care of the babies. Some improvement in the situation is expected in 1984 and 85, but how to deal with the lack of beds now is a perplexing problem.
The birth rate is going up in Oklahoma. The number of babies that are born needing neonatal special care, intensive care services, will increase as the birth rate goes up by a certain percentage that's guaranteed and fixed. The services in the state at each neonatal unit are just not enough services for the number of infants that need that care.
Baby care is expensive. One day in the hospital for a sick newborn is $1,200. Children's Hospital alone needs $1 million to expand its care. And as far as the furlough is concerned, nurses can take a furlough. Patients cannot. Bella Shaw, Action 4 at Children's Hospital.
At issue is when farmers will be liable for taxes on the surplus grain they'll get in exchange for idling their land. The IRS has ruled that farmers participating in PIC would be liable for federal income taxes when they receive their in-kind grain payments, not when they sell the grain and receive income. Ken McFall with the Oklahoma Farm Bureau says it's critical that this be changed.
Farmer may accept the PIC commodities and not sell them for several months or even into next year. And so it's just a matter of arithmetic. He doesn't want to be taxed on something for which he hasn't sold in the tax year.
McFall says if the change isn't made, a lot of farmers may drop out of the program. The House and Senate have approved legislation to void the tax ruling. Now, congressional negotiators working against a self-imposed deadline will have to draft a compromise version. McFall is hoping minor differences between the House and Senate will be settled and the rule changed before sign-up for the crop swap program ends this Friday. Ben McCain, Action 4.
The state of Oklahoma has more than 750,000 acres of school land. That land has been set aside as a public trust for the state school system. Last year, Judge Joe Cannon ruled the school land had to be sold within the next 5 years because not enough income was coming in from leases. But a weekend auction of 7,000 acres in western Oklahoma yielded some big money. 36 tracts were leased for more than $146,000. That's more than 200% higher than the minimum bid prices set by appraisers. The competitive auction procedures Cannon ordered have yielded three times more than what the state got the last time the land was leased. Cannon said that was astounding, and he may decide to reverse his earlier order to sell the land. But one member of the Land Commission says Cannon may be reading too much into all this.
My opinion on what happened out there is not anyway a benchmark happening or anything. I think there were a lot of flukes in the bidding, a lot of things that you got to take into account that is not a long-term situation.
Craig said there were exceptionally high bids on three tracts, and he said some people saw a chance to make money from President Reagan's payment in kind program. The next hearing concerning this matter is scheduled for March 30th. Commissioner Craig said he isn't sure what's going to happen at that hearing, but he said he is sure the school lands will never be sold. Bill Ross, Action 4 at the state capitol.
Disease control. I have frequently talked to Dr. Curran down at CDC. Preceded that announcement, and we've continued to work with the American Association to stigmatize a group and other groups that are already stationed that's dealing with this issue in a feasibility study estimate.
The fact that that discrimination exists makes it that much more difficult for those folks with whom you deal every day to make themselves known. And I kind of have to take issue with you saying the normal group. I mean, the question of normalcy is, as you know, I'm sure, a highly subjective question. But what I would say to you is that oppression creates a behavior pattern.